Hi, Afonso from Bundl here. Now, you may have watched or not watched our first 12 episodes of Intrapreneur Stories. Not a problem, I'm here to summarize those. Intrapreneurship is a difficult practice. You're a lot of times going against the grain of your corporate company. But when you go down an entrepreneurship venture, you have truly learned the power of having a corporate startup. You have injected innovation into your company. And you become addicted to it, just like I am. So here you have it, 6 killer insights from 12 accomplished entrepreneurs. You don't have to do it all alone.
The key element that you need to do is to build bridges, is to make sure that you can touch, you can link, or you have a network within the company where you can bring the right people together. It's about bringing great ideas to execution, and therefore you can't do it on yourself, you need the people. And I think that's what an entrepreneur does, is connecting the right people together in the company and be able to build a story around it and to bring it to a high level and sell it to management that it's a good idea.
The biggest challenge, I think, for entrepreneurship is to find these motivated people that really want to work their ass off, like it's their own startup. Whereas, of course, if you have startups, they have skin in the game. So for them, it's clear. I want to do this. This is my passion. I go for it fully. So no matter what, yeah. I will keep doing this.
Finding a team is really difficult.
People who are entrepreneurs are purely financial driven, will not work within corporates. We need the people that are more, I would say, purpose driven or process driven. That just like me, love to build stuff, or are driven by having this idea of an impact.
Availability is not a competence. If you want to involve people, you don't pick on availability, you pick on competence. You really need to focus on what do I exactly need in this part of the sprint. And who's the best in class for this, and not because the people are available, let's say, that they are the best in class. So you really need to think very thoroughly on who you want to have in this power team over and over again in every phase of the project.
Test early and test often.
I would have gone quickly to the market. I do test and validate the idea with real customers.
Yeah,
because we had a technical solution. But it's not because you have a technical solution that you cannot already go to the market. We waited there 2-3 months, but now if I look back at it, maybe the first thing before trying to make it really go to the market, try to sell the product and then really develop it.
Don't build a 3-year plan. Build a set of experiments you run over the course of a few weeks that give you a sort of an in into the playing field to actually feel, well, there's something not right here, or whoa, this is a much bigger opportunity than I expected. And increase incrementally. Don't put all of your eggs in one basket and then, you know, just wait a few months and chicks come out. It doesn't happen like that.
Design really matters.
Design makes a difference. There's a very tricky balance between sharing internally, especially things very early, because you want to bring people into the process and give you feedback, versus being late enough to actually show what the vision is and how it's supposed to look as a finish. In the latter case, I think we shared maybe a little too early and people couldn't really see the finished product. So when it came together, it was a lot better.
What this has fueled at Syngenta is changing how the team asks their question and assess innovation.
You'll love the resources, but there's a catch.
You've got goals and other people have very, maybe not divergent goals, but they don't quite understand the work process. And it's just a matter of kind of finding a compromise to work amongst a disruptive process and a stage gate corporate managed process.
I always think it's important to measure the way you handled the startup and the evolution of the startup. So you could also try to translate that into quantitative KPIs, but it's more about how fast did you do experiments? How often did you iterate? Why did you iterate? Did you interpret the results of your experiments in a correct way in order to eliminate certain options or alternatives? Why did you decide to go on in a certain way? Did you read the signals right? How did you use your budget? You could fail in the end with a startup, but you could have managed the startup in a really good way while still failing in the end.
Labels don't matter.
And again, I come back to this point that the label doesn't really matter. It's not any job title. You don't see it on business cards. It's not a LinkedIn profile. It's a mindset and a skill set and a behavior that is about being willing to step away from the herd and do something that is has meaning to you and that you believe is the right thing.
Fundamentally, what connects those is change. It's about
embracing change and thriving on change, realizing that we can always make things better, but innovation and entrepreneurship bring a little bit of the process and the structure to do that, to make all of this craziness that's going on around us a little bit easier to manage. These are tools, these are a mindset of how to embrace change and literally make life better for all of us.
A big thank you to the 12 entrepreneurs and the many valuable insights they've given us throughout the course of season one. Are we gonna stop here? No, we're not. Season two is coming out March 2019. And with that piece of information in mind, do you have any venture stories? Do you know of any venture entrepreneurship stories? Send them my way. My email is afonsor@bundl.com, written somewhere around here. Get in touch. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you soon.